Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Stalin as Revolutionary, 1879 to 1929, A Study in History and Personality, by Robert C. Tucker. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Preface. The biographical literature on Stalin has its conventions. The writer typically begins by identifying Transcaucasia, the region lying between the Black and Caspian Seas, south of the Caucasian mountain range, as an historical mingling ground of Asian and European peoples. He gives a sketch of the small Transcaucasian country of Georgia and of the Georgian town of Gori, where a boy was born in 1879, Yosif Djugashvili by name, who would later become known to the world as Stalin. Then the story flows on in chronological fashion. This book, though biographical, follows a somewhat different plan deriving from its particular theme, the rendezvous of a personality with the public political world. My aim is less to tell the story of a life than to illuminate its linkage with history, this being the life of one who in later years made himself the most absolute ruler yet seen in any large contemporary state. The book could also be described as a study in the forming of a dictator and the conditions that made for his dictatorship. A flood of Russian revelations since Stalin's death in 1953 has removed any possible doubt that his name is going down in history as a byword for tyranny. They make it incontrovertibly clear that he was a man of dictatorial personality. As usual, however, and tragically, much that is evident to hindsight eluded foresight. In the party oligarchy that ruled Russia in the early Soviet years, Stalin does not seem to have been perceived by many as a potential dictator. The ruling group included a forceful, though non-tyrannical, leader in Lenin, who was surrounded by a galaxy of renowned revolutionary figures of lesser stature: Lev Trotsky, Grigory Zinoviev, Lev Kamenev, Nikolai Bukharin, Karl Radek, and others. Stalin, by contrast, was not yet well known outside higher party circles, and many within them viewed him as a second-rater, hence not someone to be feared. He had risen in the pre-revolutionary Bolshevik movement as a party organizer, one of its committeemen working underground in Russia. In November 1917, when the party took power, he became a figure of consequence, though not yet a leader of highest rank, in Lenin's Revolutionary Republic of Soviets. 5 years later, however, he was a leader of highest rank. In addition to belonging to the key policy-making bodies, he had achieved a position of pivotal organizational power as General Secretary of the party's Central Committee. Still, in upper Bolshevik circles, the condescending view of him persisted. This helps to explain why the leadership failed to act on a warning that came from Lenin. By late 1922, Lenin was seriously ill and concerned about the party's future. He had also become convinced by this time that certain character traits of Stalin's, notably his rudeness and his tendency to be guided by malice in politics, made it dangerous for him to be entrusted any longer with the powerful post of General Secretary. And in a letter to the coming party congress, a document that later became known as his testament, he recommended that Stalin be replaced in that post by someone more tolerant, more loyal, more polite, and more considerate of comrades, less capricious, etc. The matter of personality might seem a trifle, he added, but it was one of those trifles that could take on decisive significance. After Lenin died in January 1924, his widow communicated the document to the higher party leaders. They, however, chose to disregard Lenin's recommendation about Stalin. Most of them eventually paid for this decision with their lives. For an account of the course that history subsequently took, we may turn to Nikita S. Khrushchev, the man who succeeded Stalin as leader of the Soviet Communist Party. Addressing a closed session of the party's 20th Congress in February 1956, Khrushchev read aloud the part of Lenin's testament that dealt with Stalin, and said, "As later events have proven, Lenin's anxiety was justified." Then he reconstructed these later events. The burden of his story was that Stalin, having won the role of supreme leader of the party during the 1920s, proceeded in the 30s to transform the oligarchical single-party system into a true autocracy, in which the ruling party itself was subjugated to his personally controlled secret police. He masterminded, during those years of party purges, a veritable Soviet Holocaust. Not only those who had earlier opposed him, but many thousands of others were shot or sent to camps as enemies of the people. Through wholesale purge and terror, Stalin created a regime of personal dictatorship in which one man made all the important decisions, and his colleagues were forced to be submissive yes-men. He also employed his autocratic power to promote his self-glorification. For example, by secretly editing the draft of his own official biography in such a way as to accentuate the theme of his greatness. Drawing upon his own experience as one of the dictator's lieutenants from the early 30s to the end, Khrushchev presented in the secret speech to the 20th Congress, which did not remain secret for long, a characterization of Stalin the man. He spoke of his intolerance of criticism and of dissenting views, his willingness to inflict suffering or death upon any person whom he came to regard as an enemy, his intense distrust and suspiciousness, his sense of being surrounded by conspiracies, and his thirst for praise and glory. He underlined the progressive character of Stalin's negative characteristics, observing that they developed steadily and during the last years acquired an absolutely insufferable character. In sum, he painted a classic portrait of a tyrant, a portrait, moreover, which has since been redrawn with much added detail by a heterogeneous collection of persons who could likewise, in many instances, speak from first-hand experience. Other party leaders, important enough to have had direct contact with Stalin, generals who served under him during the Second World War, Soviet journalists and writers, old Bolsheviks who survived the camps to write their memoirs, a prominent Yugoslav, Milovan Gilas, who dealt with Stalin in the 40s, the dictator's daughter, Svetlana, whose corroborative testimony is all the more significant for the fact that she writes from the unique vantage point of a witness within the family, and a dissident former Soviet party member, Roy Medvedev, who has woven new biographical data into a work on Stalin's career in power. Scholarship, however, has yet to make full use of the material now available in such abundance. It has scarcely more than begun to formulate the requisite analysis of Stalin's character and the psychological motivations that drove him to seek unlimited autocratic power through purge and terror. Still less has it penetrated the intricate interplay between these psychological motivations and his political goals and ideas. Nor, although much pertinent evidence has long been on the record, has adequate attention been given to the formation of Stalin's political personality in early life. What made him a Marxist? Why he dropped out of a theological seminary at the age of 20 to pursue revolution as a career? Why he became a Bolshevik follower of Lenin when most Georgian Marxists were choosing Menshevism, and what his personal goals in the revolutionary movement were. All these remain open questions. It is essential to answer them if we are to arrive at a deeper understanding of his actions in later life. Such leaders of psychological thought in this century as Karen Horney and Erik Erikson, not to mention their predecessor Sigmund Freud, have taught us keener appreciation of the developmental nature of personality. Character and motivation are not static qualities. They undergo growth and change in lives normally marked by crucial junctures and times of future determining decision. Moreover, the selfhood, or, in Erikson's phrase, psychosocial identity formed in youth, has a prospective or programmatic dimension. It comprises not simply an individual's sense of who and what he is, but also his goals, his clear or inchoate beliefs about what he can, should, and will achieve. Hence, later biographical vicissitudes cannot but impinge upon personality profoundly. Fulfillment or non-fulfillment of the inner life scenario necessarily affects the individual's relationship to himself, and this is something that lies at the core of personality. It is likewise bound to affect his relations with other persons significant to him and thereby, perhaps, his and their lives as a whole. All this is as true of persons who become dictators as of others. In studying such a life, therefore, one should inquire into the structure of aspiration in the formative years, and seek to uncover the view, in retrospect, the individual's attitude in middle years towards his intervening life history. As the foregoing implies, in speaking of dictatorial personality, I do not have in mind some hypothetical psychological syndrome that appears in an individual at an early age and functions as a constant quality thereafter. Such a view would contradict both the developmental concept of personality, as just outlined, and the facts of a classic case like the one before us. We can see the makings of the future tyrant in Stalin as a younger man. Nevertheless, the dictatorial personality was not yet fully formed in him. This may help to explain why many of those around him in the early 1920s, which were his early 40s, failed to perceive the danger looming up. Nor should we assume that he himself, then and earlier, had his eyes firmly fixed upon his future dictatorship as a goal. It is not clear that Stalin wanted to become a tyrant. What he seems to have wanted was political power, and with it the role of acknowledged leader of the Bolshevik movement, a second Lenin. He wanted to be the successor, just as he had earlier wished to be the closest comrade in arms, of the man whom he had taken in early manhood as his identity figure and model. His supreme aspiration was to be, like Lenin, a hero in history. Naturally, very many other people, first of all those who were Bolsheviks, had parts to play in the enactment of this life scenario. It follows that a study such as this must consider not simply the individual in whom the dictatorial personality is likely to emerge, but also the milieu, and the interaction between the one and the other. It must take account of historical factors, including the role to which the individual aspires. Bolsheviks freely accepted and even revered Lenin as their chief. His special position in the party was not a constitutionally defined office, like the American presidency, but an informal leadership role. It had a definite and vitally important place, however, in the party's practice and collective consciousness, or what would today be called its political culture. Lenin's role in the party had come into existence in the quarter century of Bolshevism's history as a revolutionary movement built and led by him. This study, therefore, starts with an attempt to delineate anew the nature of that movement and of Lenin's role as its leader. Our main subject in this volume is Stalin up to late 1929, when he completed his long march to political supremacy and won party recognition as Lenin's successor. Yet the study is not rigidly bound to chronology. I have felt free to cite facts and episodes out of later years when they were pertinent to the argument, and also to leave aside certain themes of the 1920s, such as the development of Stalin's foreign policy conception, for consideration in connection with his actions in the 30s. These actions are the subject of a further volume in preparation, The Revolution from Above. The new mode of biography, to which Erickson has given the name psychohistory, offers, as frontiers usually do, both excitement and danger. One danger is that of concentrating so much of a study's attention upon the personality of a leader that, in effect, one conveys a simplified picture of the part this factor played in influencing the course or pace of history. The challenge facing a psychohistorical study of an influential political leader is not simply to examine the subject's personality in as systematic and insightful way as possible. It is, in addition, to delve into those linkages and interactions of personality with social milieu and political situation, which alone made it possible for the personal factor to become historically important in the given case. In the case being considered here, the outcome, Stalin's rise and later autocracy, has its explanation in the nature of Stalin, in the nature of Bolshevism as a political movement, in the nature of the Soviet regime's historical situation in the 1920s, and in the nature of Russia as a country with a tradition of autocratic rule and popular acceptance of it. But only by clarifying the complex conjunction of all these can we discover why it was that in this instance personality proved to be, as Lenin belatedly but correctly foresaw, a decisive trifle. Stalin as revolutionary, 1879 to 1929. Paraphrasing the well-known words of Luther, Russia might say, "Here I stand on the borderline between the old capitalist and the new socialist worlds. Here on this borderline, I unite the efforts of the proletarians of the West and the peasantry of the East in order to smash the old world. May the God of history help me." Stalin. Chapter 1. Russian Prologue. I am not the crow, but only a fledgling. The real crow is still flying up above. At the start of this century, when constitutional government prevailed in most of Europe, absolute autocracy still held sway in Russia. Article 1 of the Fundamental Laws of the Russian Empire, issued in 1892, read as follows: "The emperor of all the Russias is an autocratic and unlimited monarch. God himself commands that his supreme power be obeyed out of conscience as well as fear." The Tsar could not make all the politically significant decisions personally, and was subject to influence from his chosen advisers in those that he made. But with these qualifications, it could be said that, in this instance, the formalities corresponded closely to the realities. The higher organs of government in Russia were emanations of the Tsar's autocratic power. Thus, the Council of State, a legislative body whose deliberations were conducted in secret, was appointive and merely advisory. It was the Tsar himself who made the decisions on passage or repeal of laws. In doing so, he often accepted the minority rather than the majority opinion among the advisers, or acted without soliciting an opinion from the council. The Committee of Ministers was not a cabinet in the ordinary sense, but merely a coordinating conference of ministers who were wholly responsible to the Tsar himself, and dealt with him directly and separately on matters within their domains. Foreign policy, for example, was decided exclusively by the Tsar in company with his foreign minister or any others whom he chose to consult. The government as such not only did not decide foreign policy, it ordinarily was not even permitted to discuss it. According to Gortschakov, one of the 19th century Russian foreign ministers, "In Russia there are only two people who know the policy of the Russian cabinet, the emperor who makes it, and myself who prepares and executes it." And commenting on his own role, Gortschakov compared himself to a sponge that is caused by pressure from the emperor's hand to emit the liquid with which it is filled. Russian government was bureaucratic as well as autocratic. The huge empire stretching from the Baltic to the Pacific was governed from St. Petersburg by a bureaucracy of uniformed officials serving the Tsar. The governors of provinces were appointed by, and responsible to, the Ministry of Internal Affairs. They and their subordinate officials in the provincial capitals served as agents of the central government. Nor, with the exception of Finland, were the peoples of non-Russian nationality permitted self-rule within the frame of the empire. Civil liberties were all but non-existent for the Tsar's subjects. Political parties were prohibited and could exist only on a clandestine basis. Thus, the meeting that founded the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party in Minsk in 1898 was held underground. Official censorship of publications was still practiced. The internal passport system, a means of control over the movement and residence of people, remained in force. The Okhrana, as the redoubtable Russian secret police was then known, had an extensive network of informers serving as its eyes and ears throughout Russian society. The Russian Orthodox Church, controlled by a state body called the Holy Synod, was a state religion with corresponding official protection and privileges. Government officials were obliged to attend communion service at least once a year and to certify their compliance with this rule. Earlier, Tsar Alexander II had sponsored a series of socio-political reforms, beginning with the Act of 1861, which abolished serfdom. Although these reforms of the 1860s brought about the beginnings of local self-government through the Zemstvo, or local assembly, the autocratic apex of the Russian political structure was left intact. Alexander himself said to Bismarck in 1861 that constitutionalism was not in accord with Russia's political tradition. Any move to limit the Tsar's autocratic power would, he asserted, shake the belief of the common people that he was their paternal and absolute God-given ruler. Should he grant the country a constitution today, he remarked on another occasion, tomorrow Russia would fall to pieces. Ironically, he had reconsidered and was making preparations to grant a parliamentary charter when revolutionaries assassinated him in 1881, ushering in the period of repression and severe reaction that ensued under Alexander III. It took the revolution of 1905 to extract constitutional innovations from a reluctant Tsarist authority. Political parties were legalized, and a mainly elective national parliamentary assembly, the State Duma, came into being. But even then, Nicholas II went on trying, in his fumbling and ineffectual way, to act the part of the unlimited monarch that the fundamental laws had declared the autocratic emperor of all the Russias to be. No true parliamentary regime developed, and Tsarism survived, only to be destroyed in the revolutionary storm that swept over the Russian land in 1917. But not even a national upheaval of that magnitude changes everything. Such elements of the old political culture as deep-seated popular attitudes toward government tend to persist under the resulting new political order. The centuries of Tsarist autocracy and of the officially sponsored ruler cult accompanying it had instilled a monarchist mentality in large sections of the populace, particularly the peasants, and the destruction or dispersal abroad of many from the numerically small upper and middle strata during the revolutionary years gave the peasant class still greater weight in the society. It should be added that the industrial workers, whose numbers had rapidly grown in the second half of the 19th century as Russian industrialization gathered speed, in many cases preserved close ties with the ancestral village. Without the Tsar, the land is a widow. Without the Tsar, the people is an orphan. So the legend of the Batyushka Tsar, Tsar father, found expression in proverb. Numerous other old Russian sayings convey the same thought in different ways. Only God and the Tsar know. Everything is under the power of God and the sovereign. Through God and Tsar is Russia strong. Clearly, the political fidelity of the Russian peasant was not to an abstract institution, the state, but to the ruler in person. Autocracy, along with Orthodox Christianity, appeared to him a part of the natural order of things, corresponding on the higher, national plane to the familiar patriarchal authoritarianism of family life in the village. Only toward the close of the Tsarist period did this sentiment begin to lose its hold upon the popular mind. The grievances felt by the peasant were many and deep, and he was not always averse to voicing them, or even to acting upon them violently. But he typically vented his feelings of protest upon the immediate agents of misfortune, above all the landlord, and exempted the Tsar himself from blame. For was not the Tsar surrounded by ministers and counselors who deceived him and kept him in ignorance of the people's sufferings? Such was the peasant's line of reasoning, and it must have imparted a special poignancy to another of his proverbs. God is high above, and the Tsar is far away. So, a tenacious faith in the Tsar's benevolence kept alive the popular tradition of attempting to apprise him of conditions and of directly petitioning him for redress of grievances. It was in this tradition that the priest, Georgi Gapon, led an icon-bearing procession of workers to the Winter Palace in Petersburg on January 22, 1905, to petition Nicholas for reforms and assistance. The Tsar would not receive his loyal subjects, troops fired upon the procession, and the day went down in Russian history as Bloody Sunday. The massacre contributed both to the outbreak of the 1905 revolution and to the decline of credence in the traditional Russian ruler myth. Its symbolic significance to a tradition-bound Russian mind was expressed in Gapon's tragic words after the shooting: "There is no Tsar anymore." The great popular insurrections that broke out from time to time in Russian history show that the peasant, even at his most rebellious, tended to preserve a loyalty to the Tsar, or to the idea of being ruled by a Tsar. There were the uprisings under Ivan Bolotnikov and others during the time of troubles in 1605-13, the rebellion led by Stenka Razin in 1667-71, and the one led by Emelian Pugachev during the reign of Catherine II a century later. Chernyavsky speaks of the Tsar-centeredness of these insurrectionary movements, pointing out that they advanced against the landed magnates and officials under the banner of the Tsar. In no case did the leaders proclaim the movements to be in opposition to the Tsar. They held, rather, that the Tsar was on their side, or that some other member of the royal family was with them, or that they themselves were the Tsar. Thus, Razin maintained that the Tsar's eldest son and heir, the Tsarevich Alexis, was marching up the Volga with his rebels, and Pugachev impersonated the murdered husband of Catherine, Tsar Peter III. It was in deference to the tradition of Tsar-centered revolt that the Republican Decembrists, in calling upon their troops to rise, did so in the name of a supposed true Tsar, the Grand Duke Constantine. Finally, the historical record offers some evidence for the case in a negative sense. When members of the radical intelligentsia went out into the villages in the Going to the People movement of the 1870s and preached socialism to the peasantry in an anti-Tsarist spirit, the peasants themselves turned very many of them over to the police. The absence of a monarchist theme from the educated young radicals' socialist propaganda may help to explain the negative peasant response to the movement. Not until the turn of the century did this situation change. By that time, the Russian peasant, and especially the peasant-turned-worker, was finally becoming receptive to revolutionary propaganda of non-monarchist character. Significantly, the intelligentsia had earlier shown a certain monarchist tendency in its own thinking, and this despite the fact that its characteristic attitude was one of estrangement from the Tsarist order. This small stratum of critically minded Russians consisted originally of educated offspring of the landed nobility. By the middle of the 19th century, it was attracting increasing numbers of commoners from among the fortunate few who gained entry to higher education. Its burning concern was the social question, which, before the Emancipation Decree of 1861, meant primarily the abolition of serfdom, and some of its representatives pinned their hopes on the monarchy itself as the agency of this great reform. Why should serfdom not be abolished by a progressive czar acting from above against the resistance of those serf-owning nobles whom Alexander Herzen, a foremost spokesman of the intelligentsia in the 1840s and 50s, called the planters? Hence, the abolitionist-minded intelligentsia, along with liberal elements in Russian society and within the bureaucracy, inclined not toward a constitutionalist program, realization of which would only strengthen the political influence of the landowners, but to the idea of a progressive autocracy. Vissarion Belinsky, the prominent literary critic and leading intellectual of the 40s, oscillated in his thinking between hope for a great serf uprising from below and hope in a dictatorship of the Tsar, acting for the people and against the nobles. Nikolai Chernyshevsky, a writer and critic who assumed intellectual leadership of the intelligentsia in the 50s, had, in 1848, confided to his diary the thought that Russia needed an autocracy that would champion the interests of the lower classes in order to realize future equality. He added, "Peter the Great acted thus, in my opinion, but such a power must realize that it is temporary, that it is a means, not an end." Herzen, living in exile in Western Europe, likewise turned his thoughts in this direction. Disillusioning contact with European reality during and after the 1848 revolution in France led him to revise his earlier Westernism. Taking his departure from the old Slavophile image of the Russians as a social people, he propounded the idea that the Russian peasant was an instinctive socialist, and that the Mir, the traditional communal village in Russia, was the nucleus of a future Russian socialist society. If the man of the future in France was the industrial worker, the man of the future in Russia was the peasant, the mujik. And economically backward, not yet capitalist Russia, blessed by the survival of its archaic village commune, might in fact be destined to lead the world to socialism. Here in embryo was the socialist ideology of the Russian populist, Narodrik, revolutionary movement that developed among the radical intelligentsia in the late 50s and 60s. What is remarkable is that Herzen, in the earlier years of Alexander II's reign, combined this Russian socialism, as it came to be called, with the theory of progressive autocracy. He called upon Alexander to be a crowned revolutionary and a czar of the land, and to continue Peter the Great's cause of reform by breaking with the Petersburg period as resolutely as Peter had broken with the Moscow period. Mikhail Bakunin, the populist leader and philosopher of anarchism, toyed for a time with revolutionary monarchism. Alexander II could so easily become a popular hero, the first Russian czar of the land, he wrote in 1862. Relying on his people, he could become a savior and the head of the whole Slavic world. He and he alone could carry out in Russia the greatest and most benevolent revolution without shedding a drop of blood. 4 years earlier, a young Russian socialist, Nikolai Cerno-Solovievich, had addressed himself to Alexander in the same spirit through Herzen's London-based periodical Voices from Russia. Proposing that the Tsar use his absolute power to carry out a socialist program of transferring the landowner's land to the village communes under the auspices of the Russian state. On the throne of Russia, declared this revolutionary, the Tsar can only be, either consciously or unconsciously, a socialist. The vision of a Jacobin Romanov effecting a socialist transformation of Russia from the throne in St. Petersburg was wildly utopian, and the radicals would obviously have been disillusioned, even if the land arrangements under the reform of 1861 had not proved so unsatisfactory as to provoke serious peasant unrest in the aftermath of emancipation. The latter circumstance, however, spurred the growth of the militant populism of the 60s, which declared war on official Russia and saw in Alexander II, whom Herzen himself had earlier christened the Tsar Liberator, the greatest enemy of the Russian people. Chernyshevsky and the other populist revolutionaries relinquished any lingering hope for a people's Tsar and a progressive autocracy. Took the view that the Russian monarch was only the pinnacle of the aristocratic hierarchy, and said in effect, perish, the sooner the better. So it was that Cerno Solovievich, for example, became a founder of the revolutionary secret society Zemlya I Volya, Land and Liberty, predecessor of the Narodnaya Volya, People's Will organization, whose leaders finally carried out the assassination of Alexander. But the change of mind was most clearly reflected in the proclamation written by a student, Karakozov, to explain his unsuccessful attempt on the Tsar's life in 1866. Russian history, it said, shows that the person really responsible for all the people's sufferings is the Tsar himself. It is the Tsars who through the centuries have gradually built up the organization of the state and the army. It is they who have handed out the land to the nobles. Think carefully about it, brothers, and you will see that the Tsar is the first of the nobles. He never holds out his hand to the peasant, because he himself is the people's worst enemy. Since Karakozov's shot was symbolic of the disappearance of the vision of a progressive czarist autocracy from the mind of the radical intelligentsia, it might seem an appropriate point at which to end the story of Russian revolutionary monarchism. But we now come to one of those metamorphoses in the history of political thought which show its inner complexity. For in abandoning the notion of a progressive autocracy, the Narodniki of the 60s and 70s gave it a new incarnation that preserved an essential part of its content while radically changing its form. From the previous idea of a dictatorship of the Tsar acting for the people against the nobles and transforming Russia from above on socialist principles, some deleted the figure of the Tsar and substituted for it the organization of revolutionaries. What supplanted the notion of progressive autocracy, then, was the idea that a revolutionary seizure of power from below should be followed by the formation of a dictatorship of the revolutionary party, which would use political power for the purpose of carrying through from above a socialist transformation of Russian society. This theory of revolutionary dictatorship became known as Russian Jacobinism. One of its early formulations appeared in a populist proclamation circulated in 1862 under the title Young Russia. The author, P.G. Zeichnevsky, was leader of Land and Liberty's secret group at Moscow University. The theory was more fully elaborated by such major figures of the populist movement of the 70s as Pyotr Tkachyov and Pyotr Lavrov. According to Tkachyov, a ruling elite of revolutionary intellectuals who had conquered political power through destructive revolutionary activity from below would utilize this power for constructive revolutionary activity from above. Relying chiefly on persuasion of the masses through propaganda rather than on coercion, they would gradually transform the country on socialist lines, building the mere into a genuine commune, expropriating private property in the means of production, fostering equality, and encouraging popular self-government to the point where the revolutionary dictatorship would itself no longer be needed. Similarly, the leadership of the people's will envisaged the establishment of a provisional revolutionary government that would carry through a socio-economic revolution from above, which would be ratified by representatives of the people meeting in a national assembly. Such was Russian Jacobinism in the setting of the populist movement. The old idea of a progressive czarist autocracy was, no doubt unwittingly, one of its sources, and it had an enduring effect upon history, owing to the influence that it exerted upon the political thought of Lenin. The populists of the 70s had been divided over revolutionary tactics, some advocating for the gradual conversion of the peasants to their cause through propaganda, as in the Going to the People movement of that decade, and others arguing for propaganda by deed, meaning terrorist action. The latter group saw the Russian peasant as a potential rebel against authority, and reasoned that an act like the assassination of the Tsar might spark a general conflagration in the countryside, a greater and successful Pugachev moment. The assassination of Alexander II in 1881 by members of the People's Will aroused no such peasant response, however, and led to more severe reaction under his successor, Alexander III. In the sequel, many radicals from the populist camp turned away from the tactics of terrorism and lost faith in the peasantry as a revolutionary constituency. Meanwhile, another political constituency was appearing in the still small but growing Russian industrial worker class, which numbered upwards of 3 million before the end of the century. Given all these conditions, it is not surprising that a section of the intelligentsia grew receptive to the ideology of proletarian socialist revolution being propagated by Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. In a number of European countries, there existed by this time social democratic parties professing Marxism as their program and acting in the name of the industrial working class as their principal constituency. In 1883, a populist turned Marxist, Georgi Plekhanov, launched Russian Marxism on its career as an organized movement by forming a group for the liberation of labor in Geneva, Switzerland, where he resided. The initial impulse of the movement, which had in Plekhanov a mentor as well as organizer, was the search for new ways in Russian revolutionary politics. The founding documents were Plekhanov's anti-populist tract, Socialism and the Political Struggle, and its continuation, Our Differences. In them, he concentrated his attack squarely upon Russian Jacobinism. The conception of a seizure of power by a secret conspiratorial organization was a fantastic element in the People's Will program. The very notion of a provisional revolutionary government exercising tutelage over the people in the process of building a socialist society was objectionable. A dictatorship of the Revolutionary Party was unnecessary and undesirable. The workers would not want to exchange one form of tutelage for another, and would no longer need tutors by the time of their future graduation from the historical school of revolutionary political self-education. Meanwhile, a premature capture of power by an organization like the People's Will, even supposing it to be feasible, would either collapse for want of popular support, or else issue in a patriarchal and authoritarian communism, or Peruvian, that is, hierarchical and authoritarian communism, should the government survive and try to introduce socialism from above by decree. Hence, the revolutionary movement should cease conspiring to seize power and give up all idea of carrying out social experiments and vivisections upon the Russian people under the dictatorship of a revolutionary party. As for Russia's Marxists, they should join with another oppositionist strata of society, including liberals, in a political struggle to overthrow Tsarist absolutism and establish free political institutions in their country. This democratic revolution would accelerate the pace of Russian economic development and permit a growing industrial proletariat to build its own independent political party, like the social democratic parties of Western Europe. In a future socialist revolution, the workers would take power as a class. In these early writings, as it turned out, Plekhanov was laying the theoretical foundations not of the Russian Marxist political movement as a whole, but of its Menshevik wing. The opposing Bolshevik wing, of which Lenin became leader, showed the influence of some of the very ideas Plekhanov was attacking. But not until much later did all this become clear. When Socialism and the Political Struggle appeared in Geneva in 1883, the future Lenin was a carefree boy of 13, growing up as Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov in the town of Simbirsk, now Ulyanovsk, on the Volga. His father, who was school inspector for Simbirsk province, and as such a minor member of the nobility, died in 1886. In the following year, Vladimir's older brother Alexander, a student at Petersburg University, joined a new People's Will group in a plot to mark the 6th anniversary of Alexander II's assassination by assassinating Alexander III. The plot was foiled. The young man was hanged, having refused on principle and despite his mother's entreaties to ask the Tsar for clemency. This event greatly helped to propel Vladimir onto his own revolutionary career. His martyred brother became his hero, and the annihilation of Tsarism his implacable aim. Soon after entering Kazan University in the fall of 1887 to study law, Vladimir was expelled for participation in a student demonstration. The police then exiled him to his grandfather's country estate in Kazan province. In late 1888, he received permission to reside in the city of Kazan, where his mother, sisters, and younger brother joined him. A year later, the family moved to Samara, now Kuibyshev, farther south on the Volga. He read for the law examinations on his own, passed them in Petersburg in 1891, and later practiced law briefly in Samara. During all this time, however, his obsessive interest and the main subject of his reading was not law, but revolution. Among the materials into which he plunged were the populist writings of the 60s and 70s. One that had been his brother's favorite, and now became Vladimir's, was the socialist novel that Chernyshevsky wrote upon being incarcerated in the Peter and Paul Fortress prison in Petersburg in 1862. What Is to Be Done? Stories About New People. In the novel's gallery of radical men and women, the legendary character of Rakhmetov particularly stands out. He is the scion of a landowning family of ancient aristocratic lineage. Soon after arriving in Petersburg at the age of 16 to study in the university, he undergoes a complete conversion through a meeting with a young man of radical views, and dedicates the remainder of his life to the revolutionary cause. He reads prodigiously. On a trip to Western Europe, he insists upon giving away the bulk of his intended fortune to a poverty-stricken great thinker and father of a new philosophy, a German. He cultivates extraordinary physical strength through strenuous exercise. By keeping to a diet of semi-raw beefsteak and black bread, and even by working as a Volga boatman on his wanderings through Russia. He lives ascetically, taking no wine and rejecting the love of a young woman whom he would have wished under normal conditions to marry. On one occasion, he tests his capacity to bear pain by spending the night on a bed of sharp nails. Of Rakhmetov and others like him, Chernyshevsky writes in the novel, "They are few in number, but through them flourishes the life of all. Without them it would die out and go sour. They are few in number, but they enable all people to breathe. Without them people would suffocate. Such ones are few in the great mass of good and honest people, but in that mass they are as the flavor in the tea, the bouquet in the fine wine. The strength and the aroma come from them. They are the flower of the best people, the movers of the movers, the salt of the earth." This novel furnished inspiration for several generations of Russian radicals. That it furnished inspiration also for Vladimir Ulyanov is well attested to by, among other things, the fact that he entitled his own revolutionary treatise of 1902, the most important of all his works in historical influence, What Is to Be Done? Conversing with friends in a Geneva café in January 1904, he confirmed that he had done so with the novel in mind. He angrily rejected a disparaging remark about the literary quality of Chernyshevsky's work and confessed that it had influenced him profoundly, particularly when he reread it after his brother's execution. "It captivated my brother, and it captivated me. It made me over completely. It's something that charges you up for the whole of your life." He went on to explain that the greatest merit of Chernyshevsky lies not only in showing that any right-minded and truly decent person must be a revolutionary, but also something still more important. He showed what sort of person a revolutionary should be, what rules of conduct he should follow, how he should proceed to his goal, and by what means he should attain it. Ulyanov's Marxist self-education began in the fall of 1888 in Kazan, where he studied Marx's Kapital and made contact with a Marxist circle, as clandestine study groups were called. It continued intensively after the family's move in the following year to Samara. There, too, he involved himself in the activities of Marxist circles. But these were not the only contacts that he made. He also sought out and conversed at length with former members of the People's Will, who were living in Samara as political exiles. In these conversations with surviving representatives of populism's heroic period, he showed special interest in the old Russian Jacobinists, beginning with Zeichnevsky and his program of revolutionary dictatorship in the manifesto Young Russia. "In talks with me," wrote one of the exiles much later, "Vladimir Ilyich often dwelt on the question of the seizure of power, one of the points of our Jacobin program. Now, more than ever, I come to the conclusion that already at that time he was developing the idea of the dictatorship of the proletariat." There is much to be said for this view. Though initially Lenin accepted Plekhanov's notion of a two-stage revolution in Russia, the thrust of his thinking all along was toward the creation, without delay, of a revolutionary party dictatorship dedicated to the transformation of Russian society along socialist lines, the dictatorship that he founded in 1917. Thus, in 1905, He opposed the Menshevik tactic of supporting the liberals in a strictly bourgeois democratic revolution against Tsarism, and gravitated to the tactic of telescoping the two stages of revolution under a democratic dictatorship of the proletariat and peasantry. And when he returned from emigration in April 1917 to a Russia in upheaval, he advocated a strategy of pressing forward from the stage of democratic revolution represented in the provisional government to that of socialist revolution via the seizure of power and establishment of a dictatorship of the proletariat. In an effort to validate this position ideologically, Lenin went back to his Marxist texts during an interval of forced inactivity during 1917 and wrote The State and Revolution, his principal work of political theory. The aim of The State and Revolution, as he put it, was to restore to Marxism the revolutionary soul that had been let out of it by such leaders of contemporary social-democratic Marxism as Karl Kautsky in Germany. The soul of the classical Marxism of Marx and Engels was the teaching that the revolutionary proletarian dictatorship was the necessary political instrument of a society's transition to socialism and future communism. To be a genuine Marxist, it was not enough to accept the theory of the class struggle. One also had to accept the doctrine of proletarian dictatorship as the goal and terminal point of this struggle. In practice, moreover, a proletarian dictatorship would mean a dictatorship of the Revolutionary Party on behalf of the proletariat. By educating the Workers' Party, as Lenin expressed it, Marxism educates the vanguard of the proletariat, which is capable of assuming power and of leading the whole people to socialism, of directing and organizing the new order, of being the teacher, guide, and leader of all the working people, and exploited in the task of building up their social life without the bourgeoisie and against the bourgeoisie. Consequently, it would be in no sense un-Marxist for the party to seize power and rule dictatorially in the interest of building a socialist society in Russia. This was the practical political conclusion implicit in every line of Lenin's seemingly scholastic theoretical treatise on Marxist views about the state. It was a very Russian revolutionary soul that he breathed back into Marxism. Admittedly, the teaching on proletarian dictatorship had a significant place in classical Marxism, and one which later social-democratic Marxists, including even Engels in his old age, were inclined to downgrade. But it had not the central place accorded it in Lenin's Marxism, nor was the proletarian dictatorship conceived by Marx and Engels as a dictatorship of a revolutionary party on behalf of the proletariat. They did not imagine that the working people, once in power, would have need of a party as their teacher, guide, and leader in building a new life on socialist lines. The elevation of the doctrine of the proletarian dictatorship into the essence of Marxism, as Lenin later called it, and the conception of this dictatorship as a state in which the ruling party would exercise tutelage over the working people, were a sign of his deep debt to the Russian populist revolutionary tradition. Leninism was, in part, a revival of Russian Jacobinism within Marxism. Lenin himself must have been well aware of this. It is less clear whether he was aware that, indirectly, therefore, his outlook showed the influence of the Russian autocratic tradition that seemed, in 1917, to have reached its end. Chapter 2. Lenin as Revolutionary Hero. Ulyanov moved to Petersburg in 1893, ostensibly to practice law, but in fact to engage in socialist activity, and quickly acquired a certain reputation as a learned Marxist from the Volga. Among those whom he met in Marxist circles of the capital were two future Menshevik opponents, Julius Martov and Alexander Potresov, and his future wife, Nadezhda Krupskaya, a young noblewoman involved in after-hours socialist activity while holding a clerical job in the railway administration. In early 1895, he went abroad for 4 months, going first to Switzerland, where he met and made a strong impression upon Plekhanov and the latter's associate, P.B. Axelrod. On his return, he undertook with Martov and others to organize a St. Petersburg Union of Struggle for the liberation of the working class. These efforts led to his and Martov's arrest at the end of 1895. After a year of imprisonment in Petersburg, he was sentenced to 3 years of exile in eastern Siberia. He and Krupskaya were married when she joined him there in 1898. In July 1900, several months after completing the term of exile, he went abroad again and entered the recently founded Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party's leadership as one of the editors of Iskra, the Spark, a new foreign-based party organ that he himself had done much to organize. Except for his return to Russia during the insurrectionary turmoil of 1905 to 1907, he remained in emigration until 1917, living mainly in Switzerland. Such are the unrevealing externals of his revolutionary biography. The First Decade. In Petersburg, in the early 90s, socialist activity meant discussions in the circles, writing on issues before the movement, and propagating socialist ideas among workmen. Ulyanov's colossal capacity for work, combined with his powerful and prolific pen, brought him to the fore as a pamphleteer for revolutionary Marxism during that time of controversy between the populist and Marxist branches of the socialist movement, and between militants and moderates within the Marxist branch. In 1894, he struck out at Pyotr Struve, a leading figure among the so-called legal Marxists, in a critique nearly as long as the book of Struve's it attacked. And he wrote a book-long polemical reply to an anti-Marxist article in a populist journal. The polemic, entitled "Who Are the Friends of the People and How Do They Fight Against the Social Democrats," went through 3 illegal hectographed editions and 7 printings between July and November 1894. Openly political socialist writings, not legally publishable under then-prevailing censorship practices, would either be published abroad and smuggled back into Russia, or, as in this instance, duplicated and circulated clandestinely, a forerunner of the present-day samizdat, or self-publishing, as the circulation of uncensored writings in typescript is called in Soviet Russia. Writings of academic style and bulk, such as Struve's book and Ulyanov's long review of it, were publishable legally, although various circumlocutions and code words, known to the radicals as Aesopian language, frequently had to be used. As an example, Plekhanov's influential book of 1895 on the development of the monist view of history came out legally in Russia. Monism was a code word for Marxism, and the author's name appeared as Beltov. Among the pen names that Ulyanov used during the first decade were Ilyin, Tulin, and Lenin. Some have suggested that in using the latter, his inspiration may have been the Lena, a river in eastern Siberia. Lenin would thus carry the connotation of man from the Lena. The populist Marxist debates of the 90s were dominated by other issues than those Plekhanov had raised against Russian Jacobinism in his works of the early 80s. The people's will tradition of conspiratorial terrorism, which still had some support, was only one of several trends among the populist groups that finally united to form the Peasant-Based Party of Socialist Revolutionaries, SRs, in 1901 to 1902. In the 90s, the two socialist camps were divided chiefly by the Narodnik rejection of Marxism as a socialist ideology for Russia, and by a series of economic issues. Lenin's contributions to the debate were notable for their uncompromising defense of the Marxist class struggle interpretation of history as the only correct theory for the Russian, or any other, revolutionary movement, and for their heavy concentration upon economic issues. He especially opposed the populists' view of capitalism in Russia as a regressive tendency that could and should be stopped, and their belief, associated with idealization of the peasant commune, in Russia's exceptionality. His principal attempt to refute these views was The Development of Capitalism in Russia, a treatise produced during his Siberian years on the basis of books consulted in libraries that he was able to visit on the way to the place of exile, and other materials brought to him by Krupskaya or sent through the mail by his sister. It sought, in Marxist fashion, to refute the populist position by giving statistical proof that Russian capitalism, which it saw as historically progressive no matter how painful its impact, had already undermined the old economy, even in the countryside. The Russia of the wooden plow and flail, of the watermill and handloom, it concluded, has entered upon rapid transformation into a Russia of the metal plow and threshing machine, the steam mill and steam-powered loom. In the Marxist-populist debates of the 90s, Lenin trained his polemical fire upon his populist contemporaries. He did not attack the early Russian populism of Chernyshevsky and his generation. As if to underline how much importance he attached to this distinction, he constructed one of his essays around the theme that the Marxists had more claim than the populists to the intellectual legacy of that early generation. This thesis was based on the highly strained argument that the thinkers of the 60s, whom Lenin called enlighteners rather than populists, neither believed in Russia's special character, samobitnost, nor idealized its village life, but desired its assimilation into general European culture. Evidently, it was through this kind of reasoning that Lenin reconciled his adamant opposition to contemporary populism with his continuing conviction that the Marxist Party had much to learn from the pre-Marxist Russian revolutionary tradition. He simply refrained from identifying the latter as populist. His political writings around the turn of the century reflect the emergence of Leninism, a word he himself never used, as an amalgam of the Russian revolutionary heritage and Marxism. One of his themes was the paramount importance of the practical side of the movement, program, organization, and tactics. This he emphasized in The Tasks of the Russian Social Democrats, a pamphlet written in Siberia in 1897 for uncensored publication abroad, and appropriately, the first of his writings to appear under the name Lenin. True, he took issue here with a surviving great figure of the populist movement of the 60s and 70s, Pyotr Lavrov. Now living abroad, Lavrov had recently questioned the possibility of creating a workers' party in Russia without organizing a political conspiracy against absolutism in the tradition of the people's will. Respectfully referring to him as a veteran of revolutionary theory, Lenin rejected the idea of confining the revolutionary political struggle to a small group's conspiracy to seize power. The battle against absolutism should consist, he said, not in hatching plots, but in training, disciplining, and organizing the workers, in propaganda and agitation among them. But save for its focus on workers instead of peasants, this approach also formed a part, as Lenin well knew, of the populist heritage. So did his way of identifying absolutism as the supreme enemy. After observing that bureaucracy, a special stratum of people specializing in government and placed in a privileged position vis-à-vis the people, existed everywhere, he remarked that nowhere was this institution so unchecked as in absolutist, semi-Asiatic Russia. Consequently, not only the proletariat, but many other elements of the people were arrayed against the all-powerful, irresponsible, corrupt, savage, ignorant, and lazy Russian officialdom. It has been observed that one common characteristic of classical populism, in all its forms, was the feeling that the Russian state of bureaucratic absolutism has been the primordial enemy of the popular masses and their intrinsic communal socialist tendencies. In the editorial of the first issue of Iskra, published in December 1900, Lenin again underlined the cardinal importance of practical organizational questions and added, "In this respect, we have lagged greatly behind the old figures of the Russian revolutionary movement. The party should recognize the deficiency, he said, and direct its efforts to devising a more conspiratorial arrangement of its affairs, to systematic propaganda of the rules of procedure and methods of evading the police, and to the training of people prepared to devote to revolution not just their free evenings, but their whole lives. Lenin returned to organizational questions in his editorial for Iskra, number 4, in May 1901. This time he spoke of the party's need for a fully worked-out plan of revolutionary organization, and outlined some features of a plan that he promised to present in greater detail in a booklet then being prepared for the press. Organizational questions, Lenin's views on them in particular, were a fateful bone of contention when 57 delegates from Russia and abroad met in Brussels in July 1903 for the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party's Second Congress, a meeting with more claim than the earlier one in Minsk to be considered the Constituent Congress. When it came time to adopt the party's rules, Lenin and Martov submitted different drafts of Clause 1, which defined the meaning of membership in the party. Though superficially their formulas were very much alike, the small difference reflected a large issue. Lenin's was the hard position, Martov's the soft. Martov at first had a majority, but lost it owing to the withdrawal from the Congress of the delegates of the Jewish Workers' Bund and one other small group of his supporters. The Bund was an organization founded in 1897 to represent the interests of Jewish workers in Lithuania, Poland, and Russia. It entered the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party at its founding Congress in 1898, but subsequently withdrew. Consequently, Lenin and his followers went down in history as the Bolsheviki, majorityites, their opponents as the Mensheviki, minorityites. The beginning of Bolshevism. In the aftermath of the Congress, the split widened as those involved grew more clearly aware of the depth of the divergence over Lenin's centralistic conception of the Revolutionary Party. Plekhanov, who now joined Martov, Axelrod, Trotsky, and others in the anti-Lenin camp, questioned the authenticity of Lenin's Marxism and drew a comparison between him and Bakunin with respect to their centralism. Trotsky contended that Lenin was more of a Jacobin than a Marxist and made his often quoted prediction that these methods lead, as we shall yet see, to this. The party organization is substituted for the party, the central committee is substituted for the party organization, and finally, the dictator is substituted for the central committee. Soon the friction between hards and softs took on organizational form as a division between factions. During a few years of unpeaceful coexistence, there were efforts, sponsored by Trotsky among others, toward unification. The split became formal and irrevocable in 1912, when Lenin called an all-Bolshevik meeting in Prague, where his faction constituted itself the Russian Social Democratic Workers' Party, Bolshevik. Born in strife, the original party of Russian Marxists died in schism. But this account of events is no adequate explanation of the origin of Bolshevism as a political movement. Underlying the division at the Second Congress was Lenin's organizational plan. This he set forth prior to the Congress in the booklet promised in Where to Begin, printed in Stuttgart in March 1902, under the title What is to be Done? Burning Questions of Our Movement. The booklet went into Russia by the usual clandestine methods, and was soon circulating among Marxists all over the country. During 1902 to 1903, copies of it were found in searches of social democrats arrested in Petersburg, Moscow, Kiev, Nizhny Novgorod, Kazan, Odessa, and elsewhere. Reactions to it were strong. The Russian Marxist movement was then experiencing serious internal malaise following its rapid growth during the controversy with the populists during the 90s. It had entered a period of dispersion, dissolution, and vacillation, as Lenin observed in the booklet. The vacillation was reflected in the appearance of economism, a school of Marxist thought which held that revolutionary struggle for socialist aims was premature in underdeveloped Russia, and that her Marxists should therefore confine themselves, for the present, to assisting the workers in their fight for economic benefits. This, of course, was deeply dispiriting counsel for militant Marxists impatient to get on with the political task of overthrowing the autocracy. To renounce revolutionary political action for the foreseeable future was completely repugnant to them. Consequently, in the prevailing atmosphere of uncertainty and doubt, they were all the more receptive to the prospectus for political action and the vibrant message of revolutionary hope and faith which came to them in What Is to Be Done. Every page of this pamphlet reflected a Hannibalian hate for the shame and curse of Russia, as Lenin called the Tsarist autocracy. It poured scorn on the tailism that invited Marxists to drag along in the rear of the workers' movement instead of marching in the van and giving it direction. It summoned militant Marxists to form a new guard under whose aegis Russian social democracy would emerge from its crisis into the full strength of manhood. It breathed a spirit of revolutionary voluntarism, of confidence in the capacity of such a small but well-organized elite of Marxist revolutionaries to build up an oppositional mass movement in Russian society and lead it to victory over the seemingly impregnable Tsarist government. Most important of all, it prescribed in clear and definite terms what should be done towards this end. And thus it pointed the way for Russian Marxists from revolutionary talk to revolutionary action, gave them a practical plan and tasks to perform. What was to be done, first of all, was to create the right kind of revolutionary party organization for Russia's special conditions. As if to reveal the inspiration that his plan drew from the populist tradition, Lenin devoted some glowing lines in this connection to the memory of the magnificent organization which the revolutionaries had in the 70s, and which should serve us all as a model. He argued that the Russian Marxist Party, unlike its counterparts in Germany and other freer countries in the West, should not seek a mass working-class membership, although it should strive to link itself with masses of workers and other discontented elements of society through party-infiltrated trade unions, study circles, and similar intermediate groups. To meet the needs of conspiratorial operation in the Tsarist police state, the party should consist chiefly of persons trained in the art of revolutionary activity and prepared to make it their full-time occupation. It was, of course, this idea that underlay Lenin's draft of Clause 1 of the rules at the Second Congress. His and Martov's differing formulations on party membership were predicated upon differing conceptions of the party itself. But only one of these, Lenin's, was clearly thought out. The party's first great task was essentially one of proselytizing. To counteract the workers' spontaneous tendency toward trade union consciousness, the assumption that they could accomplish their class goals through reform of the existing order, the members of the Marxist Party must go among them and other discontented elements of the population as missionaries of revolutionary social democratic consciousness. Using the various non-party intermediate groups as focal points for their proselytizing activities, they must preach the Marxist revolutionary word by propaganda, or the theoretical exposition of Marxist ideas, and by agitation, or the discussion of a particular grievance from a Marxist standpoint. To coordinate all these efforts and provide a nationwide forum for protest and political exposures, the party must have a collective propagandist and agitator in the form of an all-Russian revolutionary newspaper, published abroad and clandestinely distributed throughout the country by party members. An increasingly aroused populace would furnish more and more participants for a party-led, anti-Tsarist mass movement, which ultimately, after a series of revolutionary outbreaks alternating with periods of calm, would overthrow the autocracy in a national armed insurrection. The theme of the pamphlet was the necessity of leadership for successful revolution. The party was conceived as a leadership group that would play an essential part in making the political revolution by giving ideological guidance to the masses and directing the revolutionary movement. In Lenin's Archimedean metaphor, "Give us an organization of revolutionaries, and we shall overturn the whole of Russia." If classical Marxism proclaimed the imminence of world proletarian revolution, Leninism, or Marxism-Leninism, as it became known in the Soviet Union after Lenin's death, originated in the proposition that there is no proletarian revolution except through the party. But it also advanced a further thesis. The leadership to be furnished by the elite party must be heroic in caliber. To be able to overturn the whole of Russia, the organization must consist of revolutionaries of special mold. Social Democrats should take as their ideal not the trade union secretary, but the tribune of the people, able to react to every manifestation of tyranny and oppression. They should be prepared to accomplish, as individuals, great revolutionary deeds. Lenin invoked the name of the German social democratic leader Babel and those of famous Russian populist revolutionaries of the 70s, Alexeyev, Mishkin, Khalturin, and Zhelyabov, to show what miracles individuals could perform in the revolutionary cause. Or do you think that our movement cannot produce heroes like those that were produced by the movement in the 70s? He inquired. And predicting that social democratic Zhelyabovs and Russian Babels would come forward and rouse the people to settle accounts with Tsarism, he declared, "The time has come when Russian revolutionaries, led by a genuinely revolutionary theory, relying upon the genuinely revolutionary and spontaneously awakening class, can at last, rise to their full height and exert their giant strength to the utmost." Clearly, in taking the title of Chernyshevsky's What is to be Done as his own, Lenin was saying that the contemporary struggle against Tsarism had need of men like Rakhmetov. This call to revolutionary heroism sounded a new note in Russian Marxist writings. The historical role of individuals was one of the subjects of the earlier controversy with the populists. The latter contended that Marxist economic determinism precluded their opponents from recognizing the influence of great men upon historical events. The Marxists, for their part, accused the populists of disregarding class analysis of social phenomena in favor of a theory of hero and crowd, according to which historical progress issues from the impingement of outstanding individuals' thought upon the minds of the uncreative mass of humanity. Such, indeed, had been the theme of Lavrov's Historical Letters, a series of articles originally published in a Russian journal in 1868-1869. For Lavrov, the prime movers of change and advance in history were critically thinking, justice-seeking individuals whose awareness of the imperfection of existing social forms was forever disturbing the sleepy peace of the human ant-heap. Answering the imaginary objection that mere individuals could never avail against the custom-bound mass of people, he wrote, "But how has history proceeded? Who has moved it? Solitary fighting personalities. And how have they managed to do this? By becoming, as they had to become, a force." Then he visualized the method of becoming a force. A small number of critically thinking, committed, and energetic personalities, realizing that only through organization is victory possible, would form a social party of struggle for truth and justice, seeking in the process to enlist the support of allies among the masses, who have not reached the point of critical thought, but suffer from the very same social ills that the party is being organized for the purpose of eliminating. This book became the Bible of young Russian radicals of the 70s, and a major influence on populist thought. Presenting the contrary Marxist view in a pamphlet of 1898 on the role of individuals in history, Plekhanov argued that the personal qualities of historical figures could affect only individual features of events, not the general trend. Had Napoleon Bonaparte been struck down by a bullet early in life, some other individual of comparable capacity would have come forward to accomplish his life work, and the course of history would have been the same. But in an effort to show how Marxism could take account of the particle of truth in the great man theory, Plekhanov allowed that individuals could make a mark upon history by accelerating the socio-economically predetermined course of human development. A great man is great not because his personal qualities gave individual features to great historical events, he explained, but because he possesses qualities that make him most capable of serving the great social needs of his time. This became the generally accepted Russian Marxist position. Although Lenin did not directly take issue with it, his own outlook differed radically. The novel, whose title he took for the exposition of his revolutionary plan, could well be described as a dramatization of Lavrov's philosophy of revolution, and the Lenin of What Is to Be Done as a Marxist Lavrov. He too believed that only through organization is victory possible. He too wanted to organize a party of struggle for change whose influence would spread out in concentric circles from a nucleus of committed, energetic, and enlightened leaders, in this case enlightened by Marxist theory. He too saw the social ills of the great, backward, bureaucratically misruled Russian Empire as sources of material suffering that made it possible for the party of heroes to attract a mass following to its banners. Despite his sincere and fervent acceptance of Marxism, Lenin was so much the prototypical radical Russian intellectual, so steeped in the Russian revolutionary lore of the 60s and 70s, that his plan of revolution came out with a striking underlying structural resemblance to that offered in the historical letters. And like the earlier work, it was received by some as a gospel. To Plekhanov, Lenin's mode of reasoning was bound to seem, on reflection, un-Marxist. There was no place in Plekhanovist thinking for an exuberant faith in the power of social democratic Rakhmetovs to work wonders in the revolutionary cause and thereby make history. Not surprisingly, Plekhanov charged that Lenin was reviving the old populist theory of heroes and the crowd, with the sole difference that Lenin's revolutionary heroes were to lead a proletarian rather than a peasant crowd. He explained the belatedness of his critical reaction to What Is to Be Done by saying that only after the Second Congress had it become clear to him what an enormous influence the pamphlet was having upon the party's practical workers, and to what an extent it owed this influence to its very errors. Lenin, he is also reported to have said, wrote a catechism for our practical workers, not a theoretical but a practical work, as a result of which many began to revere him and proclaim him a social democratic Solomon. The older man's acid comment paid unwitting tribute to the strength of Lenin's work, its electric appeal to many of the practical workers in the movement. Particularly at that time of demoralization, they most needed what Lenin offered, a practical plan and program designed to further the realization of the party's revolutionary goal. It gave the activists in the movement the clear revolutionary perspective that they craved, and an invitation to carry on revolutionary activities, not only among the factory workers, but in all strata of the population with grievances against an oppressive regime. More important still, it encouraged them to believe that a people's victory over Tsarism was a real possibility, as indeed 1905 soon showed it to be. No wonder, then, that Lenin's booklet evoked an ardent response from many Russian Marxists. A report from the Iskra organization to the Second Congress said that, according to their own testimony, numerous persons inside Russia were becoming Iskra adherents because of this work. It gave us practical workers what we particularly needed, recalled a younger brother of Martov's, who at the time was a committee man in Kharkov. Valentinov, then a member of a circle of young social democrats in Kiev, remembers that the whole group greeted the appearance of What Is to Be Done with great enthusiasm, and even began to view Lenin as the logical man to become leader of the party at the coming Second Congress. He also recalls how receptive the group was to Lenin's theme of individual revolutionary heroism. However foreign it may have been to the spirit of historical materialism, this appeal to Herculean efforts by revolutionary heroes made heady reading for young Marxist revolutionaries carrying on clandestine political activity in the Russian provinces under conditions that were often drearily discouraging. One such person was the future Stalin, then an obscure practical worker in Transcaucasia. He was one of those who began to revere Lenin as a social democratic Solomon. In a letter of 1904 to a fellow Georgian revolutionary living in Leipzig, he unreservedly associated himself with Lenin's views and confessed that Lenin was his chosen leader. He scornfully dismissed Plekhanov's criticisms of what is to be done. What he found particularly attractive in Lenin's pamphlet was the doctrine of leadership, the theory that it was the mission of the Marxist intelligentsia to raise the proletariat to a consciousness of the socialist ideal, rather than break this ideal up into small change or adjust it to the spontaneous movement. It is generally accepted that the beginnings of Bolshevism as a separate movement within the Russian social democracy date from around 1903. But this development, as suggested earlier, is not to be satisfactorily explained by the conflict to which the movement owed its name. What gave Bolshevism its original impetus, indeed, what brought it into being, was not the quarrel at the Second Congress. It was the appearance of what is to be done. Even prior to this, Lenin was the author of widely read writings and a figure to be reckoned with among Russian Marxists. But it was the inspirational power of his pamphlet in 1902 that elevated him in the eyes of many and made him the central figure of an actual movement. What was reflected in all this, apart from the cogency of Lenin's ideas to the minds of some of his contemporaries, was the appearance on the Russian revolutionary horizon of a charismatic leader personality. The real crow had finally alighted. The leader-centered movement. Charismatic authority, which Max Weber contrasts with traditional and rational legal types of authority, is described by him as repudiating the past and representing a specifically revolutionary force. It comes into the world proclaiming the need for and possibility of profound change. The classical manifestation is the outlook of the religious prophet, who says, "It is written, but I say unto you." Weber's implication is that charismatic authority occurs in the context of a social movement that may arise outside of, and in any event is in some manner opposed to, the existing order. A radical movement, be it of religious, political, cultural, or other complexion. Such movements typically attract persons who are experiencing some form of acute distress, social, economic, psychic, or a combination of these, and who respond eagerly to the promise of deliverance from it. An individual in whom this promise appears to be embodied, whether by virtue of his coming forward with a gospel of radical change or his ability to show the way to change, is a candidate for the role of charismatic leader. Imbued with a sense of mission, he offers himself as one especially qualified to be the leader of a movement for change. His followers, who are also typically his disciples, freely accept his leadership because they perceive him to be the possessor of extraordinary qualities or powers. And this recognition of his special qualification is seen by Weber as decisive for the validity of charisma. To say this is not to imply any irrationality on the part of either leader or followers, but only that his charismatic authority has a definite messianic quality. It therefore arouses their intense and enthusiastic devotion. The strong emotional bond that grows up in these circumstances may find expression, either during his lifetime or after his death, in a cult of the leader. Indeed, we may hypothesize that the followers' spontaneous emotional tendency to surround the leader with a personality cult is one of the characteristic signs of charisma. Charismatic movements have flourished in diverse civilizations, from remote antiquity to the present age. But while the phenomenon is thus neither time nor culture-bound, these movements differ significantly across time and space in the kinds of powers their leaders are expected to display, and in the patterns of approved behavior of followers toward the leader. In a religious milieu, for example, the leader may show charisma by performing, or appearing to perform, miracles. In a setting where complete deference to those in higher authority is an accepted value, the followers of a charismatic leader will render him unquestioning obedience, and dissent from his opinions on any subject will be unheard of. But in the informal atmosphere of a modern radical movement that thrives on internal discussion and debate, the recognition of charisma in the leader need not be incompatible with argument by a follower, especially a high-placed follower, against this or that view of his. Indeed, his unusual powers of discourse and persuasion, demonstrated in such debate, may be for the followers a salient source of his charisma, one of the qualities that impel them to set him apart as the leader and accept his authority. Such, as we shall see, was the case in the movement that Lenin founded. Charismatic leaders are most likely to arise in times of crisis, when widespread distress renders masses of people responsive to movements of change, and those who head them. In the history of the modern West, one such time was the era of the Industrial Revolution, which uprooted large numbers of people and created mass misery in the new industrial centers. The socialist doctrines that appeared in the first half of the 19th century, Marxism included, were gospels of radical change addressed to the alleviation of this misery. Friedrich Engels himself was one of the first to point out the resemblance between this historical situation and that in which Christianity arose. Observing that both Christianity and modern working-class socialism originated as movements of oppressed people, he noted, "Both Christianity and the workers' socialism preach forthcoming salvation from bondage and misery. Christianity places this salvation in a life beyond, after death, in heaven. Socialism places it in this world, in a transformation of society. Both are persecuted and baited, their adherents are despised and made the objects of exclusive laws, and in spite of all persecution, nay, even spurred on by it, they forge victoriously, irresistibly ahead." The setting was a natural one for the charismatic tendencies that duly appeared. Reviewing the history of European socialism in the latter half of the 19th century, Robert Michels found a cult of veneration among the masses to be one of its pronounced characteristics. The founders, and later leaders of the socialist movements, were temporal divinities in the eyes of the followers. Thus, Rhinelanders received Ferdinand Lassalle like a god when he toured their region in 1864. Both Marx and Lassalle underwent posthumous socialist canonization in the movements they helped to found. In central Italy, socialist parents were given to naming their boys Lassallo and their girls Marxina. Sicilian farm workers marched in processions, carrying the crucifix side by side with the red flag, and placards inscribed with sentences from the writings of Marx. In passing from Protestantism to socialism, industrial workers of Saxony replaced the traditional portrait of Martin Luther in their domestic shrines with one of August Bebel. The narrowly based revolutionary movement of 19th century Russia produced its heroes, who also in most cases became its martyrs, but no pronounced charismatic leadership emerged. However, there was in the Russian intelligentsia a definite receptivity to such leadership. A profound alienation from official Russian society and commitment to visionary social goals characterized the radical intellectual as a human type. Conditions of life in Russia so filled him with revulsion that fundamental revolution became, in many instances, an acutely felt personal need, a cause worth dedicating or even sacrificing one's life to. Persons of such outlook were to be found in all sections of the revolutionary milieu, including Marxist circles, and were capable of responding with passionate devotion to a revolutionary leader of extraordinary or charismatic quality when one at last appeared. Far more than Menshevism and other Russian radical groups of the time, Bolshevism was a leader-centered movement. As a faction, and later as an independent party, it was essentially Lenin's political following in Russian Marxism. As Menshevik opponents liked to say, it was Lenin's sect. Certain currents of political thought and ideology were, to be sure, associated with it, but to be a Bolshevik in the early years was not so much to accept a particular set of beliefs as it was to gravitate into the orbit of Lenin as a political mentor, revolutionary strategist, and personality. The gravitational pull of Lenin as a personality appears to have been very strong. In a book of sketches of Bolshevik leaders written many years later, A.V. Lunacharsky, one of Lenin's old Bolshevik companions, spoke of his magnetism, ocharovanie. "This magnetism is colossal," he asserted. "People who come into his orbit not only accept him as a political leader, but in some strange fashion fall in love with him. This is true of people of the most varied caliber and mental disposition. From such a delicately vibrating enormous talent as Gorky to some clumsy mujik from Penza Gubernia, from first-class political minds like Zinoviev to some sailor or soldier who only yesterday belonged to the Black Hundred gangs and today is ready at any time to lay down his wild head for the leader of world revolution, Ilyich." Testimony from a multitude of sources supports this comment. The historical core of Lenin's following was a little group of political émigrés in Geneva who became known as the Bolshevik Colony. A vivid picture of this group, and of Lenin as its central figure, comes from Valentinov. Having been won to Lenin's views from afar by his reading of What is to be Done, this young revolutionary made his way to Geneva in early 1904, after escaping from a Kiev jail, and was received into the Bolshevik Colony. It proved to be a group of people who regarded themselves as Lenin's disciples and were worshipful in their attitude toward him. Although he was then only 33 years old, they habitually referred to him as the old man, Starik, thereby expressing profound respect for his Marxist erudition and his wisdom in all matters pertaining to revolution. "The Starik is wise," remarked one member of the group to Valentinov. "No one before him has taken apart, so delicately and well, the levers and screws of the mechanism of Russian capitalism." A belief in Lenin's great historical mission was also expressed. As one member of the group put it, "Ilyich will show us all who he is. Just wait. The day will come. Then everyone will see what a very big man he is." Despite his own enthusiasm for the leader, Valentinov was abashed at first by the almost religious, reverential atmosphere that surrounded Lenin in the colony. Then, little by little, he too became greatly enamored of Lenin. To say that I fell in love with him would be a little comical, but this verb probably expresses best the attitude that I felt toward Lenin for many months. Not all the revolutionaries who came into direct contact with Lenin had this reaction, and among those who did there were some, like Valentinov himself, who later broke away and rejected Lenin as a mentor and leader. Yet it attests to the remarkable strength of Lenin's magnetism that it at least temporarily drew into his orbit not only those who responded positively to his way of political thinking, but even some whose tendency was to oppose it. Martov, to cite a particularly significant example, is said to have fallen under the spell of Lenin's personality during the time of their collaboration as editors of Iskra, scarcely realizing whither he was being led. Another fellow editor and subsequent Menshevik leader, Potresov, published much later a memoir that is remarkable both as a personal confession and as a diagnosis of Lenin's charismatic quality. "No one could so fire others with his plans. No one could so impose his will and conquer by force of his personality as this seemingly so ordinary and somewhat coarse man who lacked any obvious sources of charm. Neither Plekhanov nor Martov nor anyone else possessed the secret radiating from Lenin of positively hypnotic effect upon people. I would even say domination of them. Plekhanov was treated with deference, Martov was loved, but Lenin alone was followed unhesitatingly as the only indisputable leader. For only Lenin represented that rare phenomenon, especially rare in Russia, a man of iron will and indomitable energy who combines fanatical faith in the movement, the cause, with no less faith in himself. If the French king, Louis XIV, could say, "L'État, c'est moi," Lenin, without putting it into words, always had the feeling, "Le parti, c'est moi," that in him the will of the movement was concentrated in one man, and he acted accordingly. I recall that Lenin's sense of mission to be the leader at one time made an impression upon me also. As Potresov pointed out, there was little in Lenin's appearance to explain his hypnotic effect upon people. Short, stocky, and bald, he struck some as resembling a Russian peasant. Aside from the driving physical energy and strength he exuded, the only physical attribute that particularly impressed others was his eyes, which were variously described as penetrating, flashing, all-seeing, unusual, and emitting little blue sparks in the corners. He was, it is universally agreed, totally unpretentious in manner, a person of utmost directness and sincerity. It was on the speaker's platform that Lenin showed the special powers by virtue of which his followers set him apart from ordinary men. These were not gifts of brilliant oratory, such as those for which Trotsky became famous. Lenin's speaking style was completely free of histrionics and striving for effect. Speaking in matter-of-fact tones, although articulately and with concentrated intensity, Lenin would launch directly into the subject at hand and present a clear, logically reasoned analysis replete with supporting facts. The effect upon his listeners was often quite extraordinary. Over and over he demonstrated the power to raise his party audiences to a pitch of excitement, a veritable state of exaltation. Listening to his two speeches at the Bolshevik Conference of 1905 in Tammerfors, for example, the normally reserved Stalin, like the rest of the company, was carried away. I was captivated by that irresistible force of logic in them, which, although somewhat terse, thoroughly overpowered his audience, gradually electrified it, and then, as the saying goes, carried it away completely, he recalled. I remember that many of the delegates said, "The logic of Lenin's speeches is like a mighty tentacle which seizes you on all sides as in a vice, and from whose grip you are powerless to tear yourself away. You must either surrender or make up your mind to utter defeat." Similar reminiscences abound in the memoir literature. To cite a vivid one, Max Eastman was moved to a state of Pindaric rapture while watching Lenin speak in public for the next to last time in November 1922, and afterwards described him in a note as "the most powerful man I ever saw on the platform." Lenin appeared to him a granite mountain of sincerity, of whom you feel that he is all there for you. You are receiving the whole of the man. It was as though a selfless intellectual had at last appeared on the scene of history, and he was taking us inside his mind and showing us how the truth looks. Since Lenin wrote as he spoke, his political writings had something of the compelling quality of his political speeches. Not surprisingly, the genre in which he expressed himself to greatest effect was the lengthy pamphlet on the order of what is to be done. At intervals in the years after 1902, he produced a whole series of them. One Step Forward, Two Steps Back, Two Tactics of Social Democracy in the Democratic Revolution, The Right of Nations to Self-Determination, Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism, The State and Revolution, The Proletarian Revolution and the Renegade Kautsky, and Left-Wing Communism, an Infantile Disorder. These pamphlet treatises shaped the strategy and outlook of Bolshevism and were landmarks in its history. Although they contained many excursions into Marxist theory, basically they subordinated theoretical concerns to the practical needs and problems of the revolutionary movement. In this they continued the tendency of what is to be done, which made the Marxist theory of revolution into a theory of how to make a revolution. It might therefore be said that they elevated the practical needs and problems of the movement to the level of theory. Even in his one abstract philosophical treatise, Materialism and Empirio-Criticism, Lenin was preoccupied with practical needs of the movement as he perceived them. In this case, with the need for a doctrinaire Marxist theory of the universe as an ideological foundation. And appropriately enough, one of the book's themes was the party character of philosophy itself. Some Russian Marxist minds of speculative theoretical bent were repelled. But this and other writings of Lenin exerted a hypnotic power over many others, precisely because of the spirit of partisan practicality that permeated them. There shone through in Lenin's speeches and writings not only an inflexible will to revolution, but a belief in it, a confidence that a socialist revolution would come about in Russia, and that he and his followers would lead it. Potresov rightly pointed to this quality of revolutionary faith as a prime source of Lenin's charisma. To appreciate its full significance, we must recall how hard it was, in the early years of the century, for Russian revolutionaries to preserve faith in the success of their cause. In Chekhov's Russia, as the poet Valery Bryusov recalled in 1920, people like himself had pictured the revolution as a far-off event that they were not likely to see in their own lifetimes. Now, for example, there is talk of travel to other planets, but few of us hope to see them. That is exactly how far away the Russian Revolution seemed to us then. To foresee that the revolution was not so far away, and that now was the time to be moving towards it, this was possible only for a man of colossal wisdom. And this is what astonishes me most of all in Lenin. Lenin had managed to communicate to people who yearned for socialist revolution, without seriously expecting it, a feeling that such a revolution was a real possibility. And in doing this, he was ministering to their deep-seated need for confidence in their own commitment. It is true that the upheaval of 1905 exposed the inner weakness of the monarchy behind its imposing facade of power, and showed that mass revolution was a potentiality in Russia. But as this revolutionary wave receded and the Tsarist regime consolidated itself, the rank and file of the revolutionary parties deserted en masse. Many members of the radical intelligentsia began to question the revolutionary beliefs by which they had lived. Russian Marxists showed a tendency to renounce clandestine political activity, thereby succumbing to what Lenin saw as the heresy of liquidationism. The revolutionary movement as a whole experienced a period of disintegration, stagnation, and decline. And another time of severe trial ensued with the coming of the World War in 1914. Later testimony from prominent Bolsheviks suggests that Lenin's faith and fortitude during those times of adversity may have been of decisive importance for the Bolshevik movement. Stalin, for one, places great stress on Lenin's instilling of confidence in his dispirited Bolshevik followers after their defeat at the Stockholm Unity Congress in 1906 at the hands of a Menshevik majority. "Defeat," he says, "transformed Lenin into a spring of compressed energy, which inspired his followers for new battles and for future victory." He further recalls how the Bolshevik delegates huddled dejectedly together, gazing at Lenin and expressing discouragement, and how Lenin bitingly replied through clenched teeth, "Don't whine, comrades. We are about to win, for we are right." Zinoviev, to take another example, gives, from intimate personal memory, the following account of Lenin's role during the ensuing dark era of counter-revolution. "He alone contrived to collect a close and intimate circle of fighters, whom he would cheer up by saying, 'Don't be disheartened. These dark days will pass. The muddy wave will ebb away. A few years will pass, and we shall be born on the crest of the wave, and the proletarian revolution will be born again.'" A significant strand in Lenin's revolutionary faith was belief in the imminence of socialist upheavals in Europe, and his visions of Russian Revolution drew added inspirational strength from a tendency to picture it as part of a larger international revolutionary scene. Already in What Is to Be Done, he envisaged the Russian proletariat making itself the vanguard of the international proletariat by overthrowing Tsarism. Subsequently, he gravitated, as did Trotsky, to the notion of a dialectical link between Russian and European revolution. In 1905, he presented an alluring image of the great perspectives that a seizure of power in Russia would open up. The flame of our revolution will set light to Europe. Then the revolutionary upsurge in Europe will have a reciprocal effect upon Russia and will change an epoch of several revolutionary years into one of several revolutionary decades. The belief in the ripeness of the major European nations for socialist revolution was one of the factors behind Lenin's espousal of a radical policy in the wake of the February Revolution of 1917. Which deposed the Tsar and created a provisional government in Russia. When news of this revolution reached Lenin in Zurich, he immediately adumbrated a radical position in a set of theses dispatched to Stockholm for the guidance of Bolsheviks then on their way back to Russia. Shortly afterwards, in the first of a series of Letters from Afar, he declared that the revolution in Russia was only the first of the revolutions to be engendered by the World War. And then went on to say that the Russian Revolution itself was still only in its first stage. These two propositions were intimately interlinked in his mind, and the imminence of European socialist revolutions was a prominent theme of his messages to the Bolshevik Central Committee in October, demanding that the party proceed without delay to carry out the armed rising and seizure of power. According to Max Weber, a charismatic leader must, from time to time, furnish proof of charisma. He must demonstrate, in action, the extraordinary powers with which he is endowed in his followers' minds. In the case of a revolutionary political leader, charisma will be most clearly proved by the demonstration of extraordinary revolution-making powers. Lenin furnished this proof to the Bolsheviks in 1917. On a party questionnaire of 1921, Lenin gave his pre-1917 occupation as writer, literator. But the years of literary activity were spent in preparation for the role of revolutionary command that he assumed on his arrival at the Finland station in Petrograd, as St. Petersburg had been renamed in 1914, in April 1917. To participate in revolution was the highest of his aspirations. As he put it in a subsequent postscript to The State and Revolution, which he wrote while in hiding in August and September of that year, and left unfinished when he returned to Petrograd in October to take charge of the revolution, "It is more pleasant and useful to go through the experience of the revolution than to write about it." As it turned out, however, writing about it was for Lenin a primary means of going through it. His direct personal involvement in the developing revolutionary events was terminated in July after an abortive mass outbreak for which he and his party were held responsible by the authorities. In the ensuing anti-Bolshevik terror, he decided to go into hiding along with Zinoviev so as to escape probable assassination. In his absence, overall leadership of the Bolsheviks in the capital devolved upon Trotsky, who only now, at long last, became a member of the Bolshevik Central Committee and formally merged his small personal political following, the so-called Interborough Organization, with the Bolshevik Party. Elected president of the Petrograd Soviet Revolutionary Council in September, Trotsky used this key position to carry out a series of masterly political maneuvers in preparation for the events of late October. Meanwhile, his spellbinding oratory worked its effect upon the masses. As the climax drew near, he directed the organization of the armed rising and capture of power. When Lenin reached the headquarters of the insurrection at the Smolny Institute on the evening of October 24th, he found operations proceeding swiftly and effectively under command of the Military Revolutionary Committee, headed by Trotsky. The following evening, the Bolshevik leaders appeared before the Congress of Soviets, meeting in the Smolny, to inaugurate the new regime. As John Reed describes the scene of Lenin's first appearance on the rostrum, he stood there waiting, apparently oblivious to the long rolling ovation, which lasted several minutes. When it finished, he said simply, "We shall now proceed to construct the socialist order." Again that overwhelming human roar, his great mouth seeming to smile, opened wide as he spoke. For emphasis, he bent forward slightly. No gestures. And before him, 1,000 simple faces looking up in intent adoration. Despite his physical absence from Petrograd during the climactic period, Lenin played a decisive part in the October Revolution. From the beginning, when news of the first revolution reached him in Switzerland, he grasped that a more radical Russian revolution was possible. His political instinct informed him that the war-weary soldiers, discontented workers, and land-hungry peasants would give increasing support to a revolutionary party that appealed to them with slogans like "Peace, bread, and land," and "All power to the Soviets." No sooner had he set foot on Russian soil than he unfolded in his April theses a political strategy aiming at a more radical revolution. Having persuaded the Bolshevik leadership to adopt this strategy as the party line, he then took charge of the efforts to put it into practice. Nor did his leadership of the Bolsheviks lapse when he went into hiding in July. While Trotsky took command in Petrograd, Lenin went on making the revolution in the familiar role of a writer. His essential contribution was to nerve the Bolsheviks into making their decisive revolutionary move when the time came. This fundamental concern inspired all of Lenin's writings and messages from his hiding place. His seemingly theoretical treatise on the state and revolution pursued a supremely practical end: to persuade the Bolsheviks, including perhaps himself, of the full Marxist...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.